Hey, what's up? It's promo guy Ian Skinner here. That's Kat Shibata. It's a picture. If you're, I mean, you probably want to listen to the video version or like watch and listen. Use your eyes and your ears to enjoy this podcast episode. But if you're listening on the audio version, I'm pointing at a picture of Kat Shibata that my friend made for me. I've got this world's worst mustache going on right now. There's a whole bit that will pay off like this weekend when I'm recording this, but by the time like an episode's out, like you'll be like, oh, it's just bad. Oh, you're listening to the SWN podcast, where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess, I don't know. Buy my merch.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. This one is actually presented by Manscaped. We'll be speaking about that a little bit later on. I am joined I had four episodes that were presented by Manscaped, but I had no kit to actually to show off. Now I've got it, so I'm excited. I am joined, you heard his voice there, by a guest you probably will recognize the voice of, because I think we've logged about 10 hours of nonsense. Still don't know what we've actually talked about. It is the former pro wrestler.
Wow.
I know, we've went a long way here.
You're going right in with both feet, former. I'm now a civilian. I'm the civilian Scotty Swift.
And you showed it off. You showed it off with no red hair, nothing.
I've got the remnants of the previous bleach job from like last December, still in my beard. Hasn't quite came out yet. Yeah, I'm the civilian. I'm a punter. I'm a fan. I'm no different than you, Billy. We're one and the same. We're just a wrestling fan. Wrestling fans together.
I don't get chucked out of events for hassling the wrestler, so that's for you.
Wow. Cards on the table. I was having such a great time. In particular, being out there for Caleb Valhalla against Conor Malloy, because they had such a good match. And I'm sitting next to one of my friends, Liam. He's a big wrestling fan as well. And I get turning to him and say, I'm having so much fun. I was struggling a little bit because I really wanted to get in there. It was he sent me a regular, but he trained for a little bit, a guy called David, and he was sitting with his son behind me. So I was, oh, amazing, David's here. So I'm chatting away to him. And he's like, how are you coping? And he's like, ask me again in like half an hour. Then 10 minutes later, I turned back to him and said, I'm struggling. Because it was such a buzz being out there. Because I don't get to do that. I don't get to be out front and take it in. And I had such a good time. And I really wish I'd stayed for the rest of the show. But I thought the best thing for me to do was just to nick off at that point and not cause any more of a scene than I did. But I was really enjoying it. I can see the appeal of you coming to the WrestleZone show, Billy, because it's such a buzz. It really is a buzz. And but yeah, I effed it up. I should have behaved and I effed it.
Shocking. I mean,
you know,
but like you're saying, you're not, you saw what we see now. You see why we write so many good things about the shows and why we keep coming back and why guys like Kaylee and Kyle come up from Glasgow to see the shows. And it's just the best time. I don't know if you listened to my Regal Rumble stuff about it.
I'm going to. It's on my to-do list. I will definitely do it.
I'll give you a bit of a spoiler. After the first match of the main show, the tag team match, Kelly, of course, is at the show with me, which I think is our second show since the birth of our son, turned to me and just went, I love live wrestling. I love this. And I was like, yeah, that's the appeal. That's the show. That's why we come. That's why we go all this way. It's an hour and a half. But that's why we come to the show, because it's worth the price of admission and the petrol and whatever you pay for Primark on the day, which is always an expense. But it's worth going because you get to see a show for 2-3 hours.
Even if you're not a huge, massive wrestling fan, it's so much different being there live than it is watching it in front of the telly. And you get caught up in it, especially, and again, sometimes there's nothing worse than bad wrestling, but sometimes there's nothing better than good wrestling. And whether you're a casual or you're a super hardcore fan or it's the first time you've ever been to it, or for the people who don't even know what wrestling is, if it's good, it's good. And yeah, I wasn't at the Rumble. I had the chance to watch back the Rumble. The match with the First City Saints and the Foundation of the Future, belter. Mm-hmm. Like that, for my money, that's your best two tag teams in the country, and I will stand by that. I will die on that hill with those two teams. That's a great way to open a show, and it looks like we're going to get more. Mm-hmm. So that's good. That's exciting. I'll also look forward to watching that back to you as well.
Well, I mean, of course, they are both officially being awarded Tag Team of the Year and One to Watch Tag Team, respectively, in the most prestigious SWN year-end awards, of course. So
they were the most beautiful trophies I think I've ever had the opportunity to see a picture of. It was no expense spared, and you really went to town. And I know the guys appreciate the effort that you went through there. So thank you on behalf of the guys for doing that, Billy. Thank you.
I had stickers as well. I was going to, like, instead of writing SWN on, I had winner stickers on them, but they just didn't like go on the trophy well enough. They just had a massive crease. So I was like, yeah, I've got a Sharpie. I mean, when it comes to trophies, I always use the phrase, what would Vago do? And so I had a Sharpie and I had a trophy. Put it together. There you go. Sorted.
Vago would make it up as he goes along. That's pretty much his mantra now. He just flying by the seat of his pants and making it up as he goes along. God bless him.
Well, it's worked. I'm actually glad we haven't seen. Of course, we've got a question that kind of cues into, of course, the return possibly of the Mosh Pit. It's about the. Oh God, I need to find it. I've got that many tabs open because I put it everywhere for questions that I need to go find them now. And
okay.
The ice cream truck just arrived and I got distracted because I'm a child. Right, okay.
Come on, keep it together, Billy.
We can do this. This is our fifth time. Surely we can do this. Martin Clunas has asked, can you ask him why he didn't complete his KISS ranking table on Saturday night while he was dog sitting? Of course, this is while you were at the Regal Rumble. Everyone's waiting patiently.
Because I forgot about it, is the answer. And also, I said to him, and I said to Caleb, and I said to Thunder, and I said to Vago, that I'm not the biggest KISS fan. I know KISS via osmosis, because they're KISS. I mean, they're a massive, massive band. So, but there's 64 KISS songs I have to get through. I recognize a good amount of them, but I've let Martin down. I'm dog sitting right now because I'm the only one in the house. So this seems to be par for the course, me dog sitting, which I'm okay with, by the way. But Martin Clunas, I will get to it. I'm not giving you a timeline because I don't know when it'll be. I'm not the biggest KISS fan, but I like a bit of KISS every now and then, and I will, I promise. Right.
I like that one where it's like, I want to rock and roll all night and part of every day.
that's a role model.
It is from Role Models, yes.
I funny you say that. I had the urge to watch that last week, so I stuck it off for the first time in years. And yeah, so a very topical quote from you there, Bill. Well done.
I know. I've got them. I've got them. I'm a professional. Of course, that is for anyone. I kind of segued because I'm saying it how it's spelled. Segued that into that question because, of course, if Omar gets it right or gets anywhere close to Mickey Vago's answer, we will get a Mosh Pit episode with Omar, yes, which I think will be incredible.
He is he's the glaring omission from the Mickey Vago Mosh Pit back catalogue in terms of the podcast. It's now became a running gag where it's just like, it's almost funny to not have him on because it's now became a thing. And I know over it actually annoys him a little bit. It's like, why have I not been on? So yeah, if he completes his kiss bracket, he gets on the Mosh Pit. So yeah, happy days. Happy days.
And I'm trying to think of other glaring omissions from the Mosh Pit. Of course, someone who I brought up very recently, who's in my shortlist for Mr. WrestleZone is Jimbo Bannon. We haven't got an episode with that.
With him. I wouldn't I wouldn't get too attached to the idea of Bannon appearing, but you do you. We haven't had Damien. Damien's a pretty quiet, like Damien is not a quiet person when he's in front of you, but on social media, he tends to, he's a little, keeps himself to himself. Damien is the big one that I would like it to do a pod, because he's got some stories. Whether or not he's to share all of them, but he does have a lot of stories.
Oh, so, he's my white tattoo. He's my white tattooed whale. That's he's on my list. He's on my wish list. White. And we try. We kind of not even get close to, like, he goes, oh, I'll be on the podcast on the Twitter on public, and then I'll message him going, you want to come on? And then ghosts me. So it's he's elusive.
He's your tattooed Moby Dick. That's what he is.
There you go. That's his name change in the group chat. Tattooed Moby Dick. And asking about yourself, though, of course, because last time we spoke, it was June 2022. On the podcast, obviously. The world was your oyster. The shows were banging.
Yep.
We were in the post Aberdeen Anarchy Glow, which an incredible show, which I think I did cry at, because the foundation were mean to me. And we had all that. And then, of course, December rolled around, and that was over. So can we technically call this the Scotty Swift podcast? Because, I mean, I don't know. Is it? Are you going by your civilian name now, or are you still Scotty Swift when it comes to these public forums?
You can just call me Scott. You can just drop...
I feel that weird. That's weird.
Just drop the Y. A lot has changed since June. I was still lamenting the fact that I missed the Regal Rumble, and now I've missed two in a row for very different reasons. I was a lot of fun. Am I still involved in some capacity? Yeah, am I still involved in the Gin Academy? Yeah, am I around as much as I was before? Not even close. It's what it is. It's like nature's way of telling me that's enough, off you draw. I don't know. And of all things for it to happen via Brian Bloody Tucker. Brian Bloody Tucker, I've known Brian Tucker for 20 years and never a crossword. Ever. Mm-hmm. And a bloody book that Reece Dawkins probably got from some rinky dink charity shop somewhere in the middle of Bumble US, whatever. Oh, unbelievable.
I mean, I visited all the charity shops. I'll rephrase that. I visited all the charity shop in Ellen when I went there in 2022. I think, 2022. I went to the Ellen show, and that was your match against Super Executioner. So that was a highlight for my night. Automatically.
Work rate. Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm still hoping he comes in the Rumble. He appears in the Rumble 1 year, because Kelly still thinks I've made him up, despite there is photo evidence and there's video proof. I have made him up.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, when it popped up on Facebook that Chris Archer couldn't make the Rumble due to illness. In the back of my mind, Billy Strachan somewhere is going, oh, I'm going to get a Super Executioner taking his place, which would have been amazing, but I guess it was too short notice for Mr. Executioner, and he couldn't make it. But I got hit in the face with a Shakespeare. I guess it's some Shakespeare compendium, whatever. The best of Shakespeare, is that a thing? That was it. A 15-year run, and that's it. It's been a good run, though.
I think so. I mean, I've only seen 10 years of it, so I assume the first five were pretty good.
Well, no, I didn't know about the first five. It's fine. Like, I haven't missed much, to be honest with you.
I mean, you're a former heavyweight champion, No Limits champion.
We don't talk about the No Limits championship because it was a load of nonsense. Am I allowed to swear?
Absolutely. Yeah.
No, the No Limits Championship was a load of fucking shit. There. Like I said before, it was a replica Intercontinental Championship that was covered in like stickers. And it's like, well, this is, and I'm like literally just in the door. Don't know F all about anything in the grand scheme of things. I'm like, even I know, this is shit. Like, why have we got replica belts? Like, I think, again, I'm not going to get to, I'm sure we, I think we have spoken about this, but it just was bad. So we don't talk about the Olympus Championship. That never happened.
I mean, did it get stolen by a company in Dundee and used as one of their tag team titles? Because their tag titles.
No, it didn't. And I think that's a very dangerous allegation you're making there, Billy Strachan. That's besmirching their good name. The kind of person who would set off a fire alarm at someone else's show. That's also no need for that. And paying people in coffers. And come on, Billy.
I think after the fifth time, I think the classness level has gone down, and it's like, right. So I don't put a lot of my own public opinion and stuff on Twitter because there's no point. It's too much hassle. But we'll get to stuff that I have put public opinion on about, and we'll discuss that a lot. It's clearly my April Fool's gag. I'm getting a bit brave with it.
April Fool's Day, to clarify, it's WrestleMania weekend. It's April 2nd. Yes, it was April Fool's Day. You didn't get me, but I sold it for a second. I went onto Twitter and I had a look, and I'm like, come on, oh, no. Remember what day it is, Scott? And people were claiming that the trailer for Ghostbusters Firehouse was online. And it took my second. No, Scott, it isn't. Remember what day it is. So I was gone twice yesterday. And we're talking about Frankie Mooney.
There we go. UK Wrestling Council. Let's just go into that subject.
Holy shit. Again. Is it just some people, some people live in a fantasy world, or they've built up things in their head for so long that they start believing that it's real? I genuinely would love to know the rationale and thinking behind a lot of, in particular, making on that you're the governing body of UK wrestling. It's like, are you? Like, what? And and they tried to do this before with Alex Shane.
Mm-hmm.
Shyster. Fucking Shyster, by the way. And 2008 to 2009, and it's like, and even then, like, me being pretty new in the door at that point then as well, it's like, this isn't gonna, it's like, it's just people once again trying to find a justification to involve themselves in something that they've no business being a part of so they can somehow profit off it. Mm-hmm. And whether it's doing shows or having a school or a wrestling council, or we're going to do this. I think, I remember a few years ago, it was going to be this wrestling tour of Africa, and some of the guys didn't know who Frankie Mooney was, so they were quite excited about the possibility, and then we had to say it's probably not legitimate. And they were like, oh, is it? And then we had to, this guy's got a history of just like again, it's the old, what am I doing this time? This is my latest venture. This is my latest con. This is my latest scam. And I give it a year or two, and it'll be something else. And I can't take any of them serious because you've got no credibility. And again, it is like a fantasy world. And I know, like, wrestling attracts some really good people, and wrestling attracts some absolute head cases. And it's not exclusive to wrestling. It's like anything, any kind of endeavor that's at some level of popularity is going to attract all kinds of different people. You get the sane ones and the insane ones, you know, the introverted ones and the extroverted ones. And because wrestling is such a niche thing, it's like people just float in and out and do it to please, because there really isn't a governing body. And there should be, but I just can't take any of it fucking serious, Billy. I can't take, there's no credibility there. Mm-hmm. At all, and the company rivals, and it was the match he had with the African guy. It's like, I mean, genuinely one of the worst things I've ever seen. And it's like, who are you and what are you doing? I mean, and they're like, if that match got taken down very quickly, because people were quite rightly going, this isn't good enough. This is awful. Like, and it wasn't bad. It was like a new version of bad. It was like a version of bad I'd never seen before. I don't know if the African guy understood what pro wrestling was. I don't think he did. It was the strangest thing. And now he's telling us what we're doing and he's going to tell us how it is. Like, absolutely not. And again, like, we're not the fucking problem in the fucking first place. And a lot in his podcast and a lot of what he was saying, it is actually the truth to a lot of what he's saying. But you know, like, you're talking about people who are the problem. Well, you're simultaneously a problem yourself. You're just a different kind of problem. Problem and a problem are still fucking problems, Billy.
Yep.
There's enough problems in the world with people coming in and creating more. And I'm just fucking sick of it. It's like, and yeah, it's not going to go anywhere. I mean, the Twitter came down and then it came back up again. And then they put up some tweet, but apparently it was a copy and paste job from someone else's statement from 2 years ago. It's like, what the fuck are you doing? It's like, did his friends or family know he's fucking nuts? Are they not fucking saying to him, Cranky, would you just stop it? You look stupid now. You're making a fool of yourself and you've got no credibility. Mind your neck in. Mind your fucking neck in.
Crazy by name. But no, on that, like the first bit you said about the African tour, that was the weirdest thing, because last chat I had was with Taylor Bryden. And yeah. We were speaking and everything, and we finished the recording, all good. I simp away because it was the boys' tea time. So that's always a meltdown in itself. So I need to get away so there was no screaming on the podcast. And he turned to me after we finished it, and we were speaking just about the Rivals stuff. It's a shame that someone was able to rip the video, and I have it in my Google Drive so I can rewatch it if I don't know, want to hurt myself.
Well, I know someone who did the same thing, Billy, so I also have access to it if I ever need to show it anyone.
Yeah, like, this is what not to do.
Exactly. It's a perfect example of what not to do. Yeah, but continue.
But he mentioned the Africa tour. So this was off the recording, so I didn't get it on the recording, but it was supposed to be on the Africa tour, and he was talking about it going, oh yeah, we were supposed to be on some African tour and we didn't actually end up going, and then I think someone died on it, and then I had to go, and I was like, whoa, hang on.
What?
This is how you can't end a story like that.
No, that's just very, very shady and again, it's like you said before, if you've been either following it long enough or you've been around it long enough, you inherently know when there's a red flag. Mm-hmm. And you'll just know. And 90% of the time, my gut reaction is pretty solid. And that's not a good thing, to be honest with you. That's not something I'm necessarily bragging about. It's because I'm right about things that are shit and I'd like to be wrong, but I'm generally not. And it's not just me, it's the guys that have been around as long or longer than I have, just like, this doesn't look right, there's something funny here, this is worded strangely, seems too good to be true, the person's avoiding direct questions, like asking questions, like legitimately reasonable questions about what your intentions are, how are you achieving this, who's involved, and just like, avoiding the question but answering other questions. It's like, okay, you're not directly giving me anything, so already I'm out.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, and it's just, he's the same guy who's sitting off, because like, he was the originator of the fire alarm being pulled at a wrestling show. I mean, like, Dave Lowe ran because Strachan Mooney walked, you know.
Dave Lowe hasn't ran for a long time, let's be honest.
He runs his mouth. That's the kind of exercise he's getting. Again, I'm sure it was the Aberdeen SmackDown house show. It was a big show against Brock Lesnar, and someone tried to get in the ring. It was Strachan Mooney.
Jesus.
And then it wasn't until after the fact when I got involved in this fucking mental world of Scottish wrestling that I put two together. Shit, I was at that house show. Oh my God, I remember thinking at the time, of all the matches to try and get involved in, you pick Big Show versus Brock Lesnar. What in the world was going through your brain when you thought, this would be a good idea? These two absolute freaks of nature. So this is what we're doing. And I know that was years ago and people grow up in a level of maturity when you're a certain age. I understand that. But I mean, he's still doing stupid shit now, so he's just a bit older.
He's an entrepreneur, hypnotist. So if you heard the third episode of his podcast, I think it was him trying to do the thing in Little Britain, of course, which is not really a PC thing anymore, but the hypnotist who was like, look into my eyes, not around the eyes. That's how I felt like listening to it. I was like, is he trying to hypnotize me? Because all I'm thinking is he's a dick. So it's not really working here.
The thing is, he's relatively articulate, and I can see someone a little more trusting, a little more naive, a little less jaded, a little less cynical, would get taken in by it. Mm-hmm. I do understand that. Because, he's full of shit. But he's not rambling. He's like, he's fairly articulate in the grand scheme of things. More articulate than I thought he was going to be. So I can see how people would be taken in. The same thing with Dave Lowe. Like, Dave Lowe can talk a really good game.
Mm-hmm.
And he can. And either you're going to figure it out or you're not. And Frankie Mooney is that kind of, I can see people kind of being like, getting taken in by him a wee bit. And he says all the right things to the right person at the right time. Maybe he's one of those kind of guys. It's very easy to talk about the negative stuff of Scottish wrestling. A lot of it, I agree with. It's like, well, yeah, you're right. But again, like, there's really too much wrestling in Scotland, and his attitude was to have more wrestling in Scotland. You know? So, if you want to set up your own promotion, we'll help you. It's like, what? So there's any Tom, Dick, and Harry starting a wrestling company now? Well, we really got that going on as it is, to be honest with you. There's like 18 promotions in the Central Belt. Go and just fucking stop. Holy shit. It's like, what?
I don't want to shock you, but I think it's 25. There's 25 promotions actively in Scotland right now. I cover 18 of them. So.
Okay. It's like, there's an answer. The answer to an oversaturation of the market is not to continually oversaturate it more.
Mm-hmm.
It's just someone who was kind of, a lot of people don't want to have anything to do with Frankie Mooney, so it's easy for him to start his own thing and try and reach a new group of people who aren't aware of his history. Just why is he associating with Africa? Because no one there knows his story, and no one's got the preconceived negative connotation when his name gets brought up. So he's had to go to another country to do something because the country that he stays in, a lot of the people involved don't have anything to do with him.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he's got this weird association with Africa.
That sounds pretty familiar to after speaking out. There were some wrestlers that appeared in Europe before they would appear back here. Speaking about that kind of thing, the pop-up promotions and having red flags and that, and because there's so many at the moment, I've kind of got the same, because I've been doing this long enough now. This is what I started this website about 10 years ago as well, the whole website thing. So I've had the red rose-tinted specs, and of course folk will still probably accuse me of having them first promotions and things like that, and the old Aberdeen Wankathon. But I think I've got to the point now where I can look at a poster or look at a logo and go, I'm going to check the likes of this new promotion. They've liked it. No, I'm not touching it. I'm not putting it up. I'm not promoting it, because I've done this long enough now that I don't, personally, I think if I have it have them on the site. I've vouched for them in some sort of capacity. I've said, ah, these are probably good. So it's just, even though probably nobody cares, but I do. It is up there. I was the most important thing. But yeah, it's just a weird world where, yeah, anyone could set up a promotion and that's it. What can you do about it? Anyway.
Correct. No, and if only we had a governing body, Philly, what would you do? That's fine.
£60 a month. That's all you need. I'll set up. I'll do it for 40.
Let's move on. Let's move on. I've said my piece there. This way.
Well, let's just go into the Aberdeen Wankathon, because of course that was the other thing. Because we as well, I've mentioned it now. We'd be as well just go into it. So of course we did our awards. Of course I didn't vote in them. The results came up. Aberdeen, the Northeast in general, just wiped the board. They just took everything, which was handy for me. It was easier for me to hand them out when I eventually had the trophies. And of course, I think two people didn't take kindly to it. One person caught me at 5 a.m. in the morning when I was changing my at that point, 6 month old. So I was not in the fucking mood for someone to go at me. The other person, I think they took offense, but I think they got the wrong end of the stick. But so two people weren't happy with it. And of course, the whole Discord happened of Aberdeen Wankathon being now a phrase that's in the wrestling vernacular in Scotland. Thoughts?
Well, let's be honest, and I'll be, well, I'm usually honest and blunt anyway, to a fault. And I know although the poll is obviously on your website and you do it, you know yourself that in the grand scheme of things, the polls don't mean anything.
Exactly. It's a bit of fun.
Thank you. I was 99% sure that you would agree with that. Although you're the one doing it, you're very aware that it's not a real indication of anything in the grand scheme of things. Like, your indication is the butts and seats and the reaction on the night.
Yeah.
And if they come back, your true barometer is the instantaneous feedback you get when you're in the ring doing something. Facts. That's the fucking bottom line. Okay. So, the poll isn't important. It was the reaction to the poll and the connotation of the reaction to it really fucking offended me.
Mm.
And I'm not speaking about me personally, because I've never been a critically acclaimed wrestler. I'm not the good wrestler. I'm not the five star guy, whatever the fuck five star means, right? I never was. I'm definitely not now, because I'm good at dancing in the ring. Excuse me. But I was never that guy. So me not winning stuff or being picked with them, I genuinely don't give two fucks. I don't care, because I'm not that guy. I'm not the good wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. I'm the sports entertainment guy with the red hair. That's what I was. That was my role, and I was completely happy with that, and I think I did well with it for whatever my level was and what my level could be. It's a genuine slap in the face to the guys who are, like, really talented, like, in a way that I was never able to be and never was. And people, in particular, Andy Wild and Bobby Roberts, I'm just going to say it, because fuck it. Their first notion was, it couldn't be possibly that they won just because the guys are talented. And it was like, that's really fucking offensive to me.
Mm-hmm.
And go fuck yourself for thinking that. Like, it couldn't possibly be just because the guys we got just now are really talented and really good, and the shows are strong and they're delivering. It couldn't be that, because it's because of where we're based. Like, that's genuinely fucking offensive. And that pissed me the fuck off. And now that I'm saying it out loud to you, I realise how annoyed I am about it. I don't give a fuck about the poll. because the polls are just a bit of fun. They're a bit of nonsense. It's something that, you do to entertain yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's totally fine. You know, someone can vote for a show that wasn't any good, but the pals are on it. Someone can vote for a wrestler as wrestler of the month, and they're not wrestler of the month, but their pals voted for it because they wanted to win. Fine, whatever. Do what you fucking want. It's fine. But the fact that Bobby, who I've only met a handful of times, and by all accounts, like didn't behave like a child over a pole, because you're a grown man. That's really embarrassing. So don't do that. Because I put a tweet up and it's like, I can't, like, no, like, why are you tweeting this? You're just stupid. Wise up. And Andy, who I've known for a long time, and it's like, Andy, you know that we're good for it.
Mm-hmm.
But you had your little tantrum there for some reason, and it's like, it couldn't possibly be because the guys involved in the company who kind of reignited your passion for it a wee bit because you were struggling. And that's not my words, it says. And the first, and your mind immediately goes to, it can't be because the guys were just good.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm not talking about me, because I'm not the critically acclaimed guy.
Yeah.
Dynamite is, Aspen Faith is, a Ronan King is, a Caleb is, a Foundation, Conor Malloy. Like, these are your critically acclaimed guys. Like, Damien, like, they're the guys that, they're your match of the night guys. I that was never me, unless I was in there with someone who could give me a match tonight. Because I wasn't doing it off my own merit, like, it could help me out a little bit. But I was personally offended on behalf of them because I thought it was disrespectful to all of them.
Mm-hmm.
So for having that reaction to that, fuck you. Calling it an Aberdeen Wankathon, fuck you.
I know, it was even worse is some of them were based in Perth, so, you know.
Yeah, oh yeah. And but you said that but being like, annual Wankathon, it's like we've been dismissed forever. It's like, so now you're just telling lies because you're bitter about something? Bobby, I don't fucking know you. Shut the fuck up. It's stupid, it's silly, it's just a poll. Wise up.
What we'll say though is I had a chat with Andy like through DMs and I actually got him on the podcast as well. So we kind of, I think we worked out, it was just a bit of a knee-jerk reaction. We had a discussion, it was all good, all settled. I haven't spoken to Bobby, but I seem to have went on, I've joined his side on the whole UK Wrestling Council thing. So we kind of have not buried the hatchet, but we found a common enemy. We'll just ignore it.
Funny you say that, because I don't know who I was speaking to. Who was I speaking to about stuff? I might have been speaking to Omar and Oliver Green, who debuted at the Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
Love him. He's gonna be really good. I love him. He's great guy. And like me and Omar were talking about stuff, and I mentioned that it's like, when something comes up that's so much more of an issue than the stupid little things that annoy you for one day or like 48 mm-hmm. hours, we're all unified because this one person's really fucked it and we're all on the same page, and then it goes away again.
Hey, yeah.
So that window is like, it doesn't matter, you know, my thoughts and opinions. And again, it's like, I'm very reactive. I'm like, you know, it didn't take a lot for me to get annoyed on behalf of all the guys, what we spoke about there. On behalf of the guys, I was annoyed on their behalf because
mm-hmm.
it fucking pissed me off in a big way, because I thought it was disrespectful to the guys and how talented they are. But for a small window of time, you know, like this wrestling council, all of us were all just like, yeah, that's shit. For one day, we're all like, shit.
It was nice. But I sold a t-shirt. I did sell a rig pole t-shirt. That was nice. I was, worked for me. Nobody's bought my follow-up, but I haven't really advertised it because I was going to do it at the start of May. I've got one that says Granite City and it's got 5 stars on it. So, keeping that one. Might get that one for myself, actually, for Anarchy. It's my own t-shirt.
I think I've covered it all there. It's just, it's said about the annual Aberdeen Wankathon, but it's not an annual thing because we generally, and also, and it's good, and also because the Garcia thing, the polls don't matter anyway. So what's the problem? It's just fucking mental, and like we're all like deep into a man. Come on now.
I know, wrestlers need you.
Yeah, very, very disappointing behavior, to be honest with you. It's like, we deserve a little better than that. The poll is not the poll, it was the connotation of the reaction to the poll was the problem. The poll itself was not important at all.
I know. It was I saw folk get annoyed at the SWN 100 as well. Which was hilarious because it's a win loss record. It's not real. It's based on it's purely statistical. It's not actual opinion. So,
we speak about, you know, not obviously not just wrestling, but any organized thing which includes a group of people that's a large amount. You're always going to attract different kind of people or certain kind of people just through law of averages. But wrestling completely attracts people who any kind of insecurities they just shine through. And it's like, and there's, I mean, yeah, there's, and like anyone who's like a performer or like an athlete or a musician, there's something like inherently fucking wrong with this. You know, like there's something not quite fucking right, but it's keeping the checks and balances. And again, speaking about being grounded, an Aberdonian thing about being grounded and shit. If any kind of insecurities, like it just gets inflated and magnified by like times 100, and it's like, whoa, it's like the top 100. It's like, why is this guy sick? Because he won the most matches. Oh my god, Nova, hi. We talk here.
Best cameo.
Nova. Hey. Nova, a paw. Good girl. A kick. Oh, thank you. Yeah, there we go. And she's away again. Bye-bye. That's it. In and out, running. She did a running and then she went away again.
That's fine. That's why I'm going to say there's a dog in this video and that'll get the hits up. That seems like a good time to go for the ad. So this is going to be fun. First question I've got for you on account of the ad, so we could go into it, is Scotty, how's your balls?
My balls?
Your balls.
Well, I mean, my balls, well, I had a shower today, but I guess down there could be a little bit tidier, Billy. What do you think?
Oh, well done. Well, thanks to Manscaped, I've got the Performance Package 4.0, and it is a game changer. Just ignore my eyes looking at the read here. Inside this package... Inside this package, you'll find their lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, which I should have opened this before I did it. Oh, here it is. 4.0 trimmer. Oh, God. Weed whacker, ear, nose, and hair trimmer, which is here. Crop preserver ball deodorant. This one, which is here. God, what else? I should practice this. Performance crop reviver toner, which is here. Ball, was it? Ball, just be shouting ball. Performance boxer briefs. I had a travel bag to hold your goodies, which is, it's underneath this. It's nice. Anyway, oh God, there's so much more to read. There's a lot of good stuff in it. Go get it. I'll do the crop. The crop. I am flustered. I'm talking about balls. support SWN because it's bought to you by Manscaped, who's the best in men's below the waist grooming. Their products are precision-engineered tools for your family jewels. This will look way better on the audio because you won't see me doing this. Manscaped Performance Package, the ultimate men's hygiene bundle, which is what I've got there. You can get it for yourself with 20% off and free shipping. Use the code SWN20. If you go to manscaped.com, 20% off, free shipping with the code SWN20. There you go. There's the ad read. I'm going to put all this stuff away. I haven't used it yet. In the next episode, which will probably be episode 200, I will look revived with my balls all trimmed.
And just remember, guys, the amount of attention you pay to shaving and grooming your face should be the same amount of attention you give to your balls.
There we go.
There you go.
If I get a cut, you're definitely getting not obviously of the profits. Oh God, right? Okay, let's move on. Right, okay. So back to the question.
That was of all the of all the podcasts I've listened to that have been sponsored by Manscaped, of which there's many. That is somewhere in the middle.
That's the most chaotic ad read that I've done. I just couldn't be arsed recording it later, to be honest. I was just like, I'll do it during this. Caleb's got some questions. First, the mighty Caleb Valhalla, Regal Rumble 2023 winner, which yes. There was video evidence of the quickest I've ever seen Kelly move, because I think Caleb's wife put up a video of her view, and there was a sea of people when he got Brad over the top rope. Kelly was the first one up, and I was like, oh, Christ, you're up. I better get up. I better stand up then. And ace. Right. So he asks, am I Cena or Cody?
He's Cena. So do you know what this is in relation to, Billy?
I do not.
Caleb, it's a freak thing. He had a partial bicep tear. And if you know what you're looking for with kind of subtle, like, deformities of, like, muscle injuries, then you can tell the difference. If you don't know what you're looking for, you can't tell. But if you're aware of it, then you can see a change. And this was before the Rumble. So he had a wee panic and was talking away. And he sent him a picture. I'm like, okay, that does look a little bit different. And when I tore my pec in 2018, I had trouble with, I tried to work through it, and then I ended up getting told you need to stop because it was starting to affect what I was doing. Like, to the point where me and Crusher had a bad match. And I was like, well, I fucked that, because that shouldn't be fucking happening. It's because I shouldn't have been in there. But he was basically told he had the option of getting surgery and being out for a wee bit, or he could train through it and he'd probably be okay because it wasn't a bad tear. So Caleb being Caleb, is that, well, I'm gonna work through it. And within like a matter of a week, it was like he wasn't where he was before the injury, but he wasn't far off it. So I kept saying to him, well, you've seen it, that you're John Cena, and you've seen it. So he isn't Cody, because Cody had to really take that time from the torn pec.
Mm-hmm.
And I sympathize with it, because although his was significantly worse than mine.
Oh, it was disgusting.
Awful. Like, mine was like 30% of that was a discoloration. So he is Cena. He's seen it, and then he goes on to win the Rumble with a partially torn bicep. So he's just a machine. So,
and he killed Mr. Malice.
I mean, sure, there in 1 second. Yeah, that was absolutely mental. Malice, the continuing adventures of Malice perishing.
It was just...
Absolutely not. But, so even with the turn, the personal torn bicep, he still managed to kill Malice. Goes on to win the Rumble. He's going on to main event Arianaki. And he's all doing it where, technically, he could have gone the surgery, but it wasn't bad enough that he couldn't work through it. And also because he's so jacked anyway. Everything else around it is solid. Not like an average person walking the street would probably struggle a bit more. And also, it's the wrestling mentality of, I'll be fine, which I wouldn't recommend to anyone.
Mm-hmm. No, he's
when you're in it, you'll know yourself if you can work through it and how bad it is. Only you can fully know.
Mm-hmm.
He made a judgment call, and in the grand scheme of things, he's doing really well.
Good on it.
Like John Cena, he is our John Cena in terms of the X-Men style recuperative mutant
power. And also, he is a lovely man, terrifying man between bell to bell. But outside of that, a very lovely man.
Now that his head's been shaved, he looks even scarier. But
I just like to see myself in him, you know, with the bald head. But you know, that is, if the sliding doors, if I didn't go into that particular kebabber that one night, that could have been me. But you know, I chose food. So we've got these other questions. He's put thoughts on the Regal Rumble debuts, sorry, debutantes, which is Oliver Green was one. There's quite a few folk that actually had their debut Rumble match.
From what I can remember from watching backstage, we had three debuts and a return that got quite the reaction with Ted O'Keefe. He's back. And it was like, people were like, oh, okay. Because again, any kind of a Rumble match where you can have a surprise return, it's always a good time. Whether it's someone you liked or disliked when they were around. So that was encouraging for him. Deacon Matthews.
Of course.
Deacon Matthews is a guy who, like, I feel like I've known him forever, but I don't actually know him. Does that make, you know what I mean by that? Does that make any sense? Like, and chatting away to him on Facebook, and he, because I couldn't remember if we'd ever met before. And it turned out we did. We met one time at Source, a training session. But the one and only SSW show, SSW, oh God. The one and only SSW show that I ever did, and worked a four-way match, and then the winner of the four-way would go on to face Jason Rotunda for whatever belt he had.
Former WWE superstar.
Yeah, he did. Thank you, Billy Strachan. So I won the four-way, went on to have the match with the Rotunda, and then he reminded me that after the match, there was a couple of like goons were like attacking him, and basically Neil Rotunda was going to turn face off it, and I saved him, and one of the goons was Deacon. And I'm like, I did not put two, because it was like 2011, and I didn't remember it was him. I was like, and a big pop. It's like, oh my God, like, you were one of the goons. It's like, yeah, it's amazing. So seeing him involved in WrestleZone is great, because I think the cult of positivity and the way he goes about doing things is a really nice fit for the company. So that was cool. And we had this guy with a mask and a cape and a smaller cape under his big cape, which is weird. And Brian Tucker seemed to think it was me, and I'm sitting at home with a dog. So unless I'm like a real life David Copperfield, and magic is no longer an illusion and it became real, I don't know how I'm performing that trick, really.
But I mean, you have the evidence. The evidence is out there.
Yes. Did I want to meet a Rumble? Yeah. It was actually so that it's funny. My girlfriend, she went to the show, and my mate Liam, he was going with his fiance, and he bought a ticket for me. And I said to him, well, last time I was at a show at the Station Hotel Showdown, that didn't go very well. So I'm probably not going to try to do that again. So he actually gave Charmaine the ticket, because her favourite matches, a good Rumble is her favorite match of the year, you know, Raw Rumble, Our Rumble, whatever. She loves her Rumble. So Liam gave her my ticket, which meant, I guess I'm dog sitting. So she was there and I wasn't, which is bizarre. And the show was legitimately sold out anyway, to the point where Jonathan Geddes was not at the Rumble because it was sold out.
We didn't see him. We were wondering. I thought he'd saw that it was Archer versus Vago, and he was like, "I can't." He couldn't choose. He couldn't be there.
Sold out. The show was sold out, and that was it. Because the show was sold out about 2.5 weeks before the show actually happened. So, all right. If it was any consolation, I wasn't there either. So we're both in the same boat. So,
what I will say is Oliver Green. Anyone who gets an armpit tattoo is hard as nails, and I will support him being hard as fuck.
I really need to ask him properly what possessed him to get a tattoo of that size in that area. Oliver Green, yeah, he's I like him a lot. He's a lot of his people have had a hand in helping him out, but it's like I've been a fair bit with him and stuff, and he fits early days for him, but hey, he's doing it. Lots of people talk about doing it. Lots of people shop for a week and disappear. Some people get for a month. Some people hang about for a period of time and then you never see them again. So as far as I'm concerned, he's won already.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he was absolutely terrified. But if he wasn't terrified, then he's doing it wrong. Because mm-hmm. if he didn't, I mean, when you don't care, then you wouldn't be nervous. And so it's fine. So whatever's in his future, I'll be really, really excited to see it because he's put the time in and he deserves to be there. And that's why he's there, because, you know, he's a smaller guy, but it's 2023 and to me, that is not any, that's no longer as significant a thing as it was 20 years ago. Watching Rey Mysterio go into the Hall of Fame, and then no spoilers in case, I mean, the thing just comes out, same which I've seen WrestleMania, but him and Dominic had their match last night. It was like, someone like Rey Mysterio, 5'3", 150 pounds, shouldn't really be in there doing it, but he's one of the greatest of all time, so size knows no boundaries when talent prevails, so expect good things from Oliver Green. Expect good things from Oliver Green, definitely.
And plus, we're starting to build this this Rainbow Crew that I'm hoping to see in the future with Oliver Green. Of course, Blue Thunder still break glass in case of emergency. I mean, Adam put out his predictions for his hopes and predicted card for Aberdeen Anarchy, and I did it at the exact same time, but I took mine down. And I had in my head, I was like, oh, Blue Thunder, Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden, he could be yellow. There we go. There's your little Power Ranger crew for Aberdeen Anarchy. Or your starter Pokemon. You could be red. If you decide to put the boots back on, you're Charmander. So there we go. We've got the starter Pokemon ready to go for a WrestleZone. So
I'm going to shake my head in agreement and pretend that I know what you're talking about with Pokemon.
You know. It's one of those memories or thoughts you have in your head. You're obviously Charmander. But anyway, right.
Catch as many as you can. That's what it is.
I think that's the ones you get in like the shop that don't want to actually pay a license at all.
In the bootleg.
get them if you want.
You have to obtain the majority. That's what it is.
Other question from, we've got two more from Caleb. He's put, can he get Mr. WrestleZone to stop messaging me?
I have a question for Caleb. It's like, could Caleb get him to stop messaging me? Because I'm also getting a message from Mr. WrestleZone. Because he is excitable. He's a big fan. And he spoke about getting that message at five o'clock in the morning. Yeah, he's one of those. Like, I'm in my bed. Go not. Please don't. So I will ask him to stop messaging Caleb if Caleb tells him to stop messaging me. That's what we'll do.
Conspiracy theory for you. You said, of course, you weren't at the show because you were dog sit. Again, proven. We've got proof, video evidence. You said Jonathan Geddes wasn't at the show. Is he Mr. WrestleZone?
You know what? No. I'm never going to play it off. No, he's not. I'm pretty sure he isn't. But what a turn up for the boots if it was revealed that all along they pulled it off. It was me, Billy. Oh, son of a bitch.
He's going to be there and go take his mask off and go, Scott Leggett, I knew you'd come. I feel so weird calling you that. That's just so natural.
God damn it, Billy. Come on. Well, that's it now. I guess I am. I am just plain old Scott now, and that's it.
Yeah. But it's like meeting a teacher outside of school. It's like, I know you're Scotty Swift. You're Scotty Swift. I've known you as Scotty Swift for 10 years. I'm not changing that at this point. People calling you. So when people message me going, can you ask Scott this? I'm like, who? No. I'm not asking Scott anything.
Absolutely not.
The last question that he's got here is, will you come back for a Hoss and Toss reunion at some point? That sounds awful. Hoss and Toss versus Ryan Riley and Bruiser Brad. Please and thank you.
Well, I spoke about Hoss and Toss last time, you know, but we just be like the, you know, like Legion of Doom slash Signers and just, or you know, the Powers of Pain, you know, like Warlords and Barbarians, just chucking people about. And unfortunately, chucking about Bradley Evans might be difficult for me. I'll be honest, because like, he just gets wider and wider every show.
He's a
big boy. I don't know. I think if it talked into coming back for one more, I think Hoss and Toss has got a pretty good chance of being the reason to put the boots back on, maybe do some Hulk and Animal style face paint and just murder people. Yeah.
right. Okay. So off back into maybe negative stuff. Of course. That's right. I've got happier questions.
Okay.
So. Right, I don't know how you're going to answer this, and I'm very interested how. Of course, Community Pro Wrestling are coming up to the Northeast for Peterhead. I spoke to Ravy Davey about it, and for everyone who wants to confirm, yes, he thought he was going to wrestle on the football pitch. But there we go.
Okay. Okay.
Where, as you're no longer wrestling in WrestleZone, I would have loved it if you actually turned up on Community Pro Wrestling, because it's like, oh, I can't wrestle in WrestleZone anymore. But, you know, obviously not to be, for reasons, you know, you can discuss or not.
Well, I mean, what do you want to know, Billy? Just tell me what you really want to know.
Would you have done it if you were asked?
Nah. Because I just... I really, like I said already, I love WrestleZone. I like the fact that it was local. I'll be after the lockdown and being forced to be a homebody, like I didn't hate it. And I didn't know it. I just be completely honest. I can't be arsed. I can't be arsed being away for a whole day or when I'm a day's off and getting back 1 o'clock in the morning anymore. I don't mm-hmm. want to.
That's fair. That's
after the lockdown and stuff from my parents and stuff and everything and having 2 really shitty years, it's like I just something changed a little bit, and I just don't care the way I used to. I love WrestleZone. I love the academy and being able to help in whatever way I can. I'm happy with the people that have came through it on a personal level. The crew at WrestleZone is the best crew in the country. Facts. Don't care if anyone's forgiving this. I don't care if you're offended. Don't fucking care. But that's how strong I feel about it. if I was 20 years old and wanting to be wrestling as much as I can, then yeah, I'm 43 this year and I can't be fucked anymore.
Yeah, so your bump card is kind of maxed out. You can pick... If you were to go back, you're picking and choosing it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, is that? I just I like being at home. It's like working full time and stuff with the academy and other and having a life, and then just like, you know, then I get to like a maybe I've got a Sunday to myself. I don't want to do anything. I just want to be home. Why? Because I'm busy all week. You know, I'm over it now a wee bit. I'm over it. And sometimes maybe with some companies and stuff, that there'll be people on the show that I can't be fucked with.
Mm-hmm.
So, am I going to spend my one of my few days off backstage with a couple of people that I wouldn't speak to on Facebook when I could be at home or doing something with people that I really, you know what I mean by that? I
absolutely get it, and not in a wrestling sense of the world, but for this I'm doing now. This is to do to schedule a recording now. It's so difficult to do because I've got to work it around, you know, grown up stuff. And if I work 9 till 5, I can't do evening recordings because the boy gets fed at 5. I get an hour and a half with him, and then he goes to bed. So that is a priority hour and a half for me. So I can't do evening recordings because he sleeps in the next room over. So I don't want to shout and wake him up. So now I have to do weekend recordings. But because there's wrestling shows on, it's difficult to get wrestlers on because, you know, they've got shows to go to. So I've gotten to the point where I'm like, I'm driving to 200. If I get to 200 episodes, then I'm going to still do recordings, but I'm nowhere near as frequently as I can because it's just too difficult to do. It's too difficult to set up. It's just, and I'd rather spend time with my boy than have to hustle about. And because I've just about interviewed everyone I want to, you know, I got Grado, I got Joe Hendry, I got one of the Highlanders. I've got a pretty good list. I've got some I still want to get, and if I got them, ace, I would make my time and get them on. But I'm like, I've done 200 episodes or so. I think I'm all right. I'll do maybe one a month, one a fortnight. So I get what you're saying. It's prioritizing real life over and stuff that actually satisfies you in the case of being able to pay bills and being able to do things over quote unquote a hobby. You know, it's just prioritizing what to do.
Is that the thing as well? This is my a slight tangent, but somewhat related. I don't know who I was talking to with this about. I can't remember. I think it's my mate Lindsay, because he feels the same way about stuff. It's like speaking about the spectrum, and speaking about autism, and it's like, everyone's autistic.
Oh yeah.
Everyone's autistic, and it's like I know I'm definitely fucking, because it's like, you know, it's like when you work or you have stuff that takes away from your time, and then so let's say here's like an example, you know, like you usually, let's say you used to get home for like 5 o'clock or whatever, and then you get settled, and then you get the night to yourself. But then, so you're used to having that window of time that you can control. You can control time. Now, like, you can't control your work life because that's been regimented. But let's say from 6 o'clock to 11, that's your control time. Then let's say one time you get in for 10 o'clock, and you get settled and it's 10:30, and maybe you haven't to wait tea, you haven't ate yet, which happens to me sometimes. So I get to 10:30, so I've got maybe like half an hour controlled, like time that I can control, but I don't want that. So I should be in my bed for 11 o'clock, but I'll be in my bed for 12 o'clock. Why? Because I wanted an hour and a half of time that I was controlling. So autistic. So on the spectrum. And then, if I was just like, okay, here's my night. I've got this night, maybe Saturday night or Saturday, whatever. It's like, oh, and then I'm away for the whole day, wrestling for a company, when really my heart's not really in it the way it used to. Now, I can't control that time now. So now I've given up a day of time that I can be in control of, and my autism goes, no, I don't like that. It's absolutely an on the spectrum thing. And we all are, whether we're a little bit or heavily, we're all on the spectrum. And but where I did it for WrestleZone, it's like it was like my happy place. It was a safe space. It was like, I like everyone, I know everyone. I really enjoyed it, and you know, I'll always be proud of it. And it wasn't like people, it wasn't like I had fucking people batting down the doors to fucking book me. They weren't. I mean, I had Pro 2, like when, fortunately, it might come up like Reckless Intent Wrestling's on hiatus just now, which I didn't see coming. But they wanted a tag team, and Umar said, oh, me and him. And I just said to him, nah, because my heart was in, like, and it's not to do with him, because I love Umar to bits, he's amazing, but I'm going, if I was to say yes to that and my heart's not in it, there'll be someone who's like really wanting to do that. So I'm taking a spot for a Ronan King or a Connor or the guys like Judas Gray, all those young guys. All these guys are like in a in my heart's really not in it, and I'm just doing it for the sake of doing it. Just don't do it, because there'll be someone who really want to do that.
There's someone hungry for the opportunity while you're in your mind taking it.
Yeah, it's like, so like, what the fuck am I hanging about in the road with someone else who could really, really want it? So I said to Omar, I was like, nah, because someone else will really want to do that. And I just didn't want to go home. I didn't want to go home on Saturday at like 1 o'clock in the morning. I didn't want to. I just don't want to. I just don't want to. I've now been spoilt with the being home after a show at like a reasonable time. Because sometimes my favourite part of a show was the being home for 10:30. I love the show, but my favourite part of the show was being home for 10:30. And there's a few of the boys that think that way. And it's like, it's great.
That's why you guys never got in trouble. Well, you're all boring. I think that was the kind of what we were saying in one of our first chats. It's like, all the wrestling guys are quite boring. The show's over. They want to go home. That's it.
Again, and the guys who do go out after the show don't get up to any misbehaving. So, you know, it's just, again, if it was in my early 20s, again, no, like if I started doing this earlier, we might be a totally different story. To even be a part of WrestleZone, and you think at any given time how much spots there is on a show. Maybe like 20 maybe. You know, like 20, maybe 25, depending. Obviously the Rumble's got more people, whatever. But you know, like when you think about the available positions to be involved in that crew, and I was one of them, out of everyone. You know, and I say to some of the guys, like, you know, they're like, you're one of 20 people in the country. There must be a fucking reason why you're here. You know, it's like, why are you here and not one of the other 200 or 300? What? Why? No, there must be something. No, there must be a reason. It's all by coincidence. It's like, it's definitely because that person fits. First and foremost, they fit. And then the second most important thing is the wrestling. And whether you're work rate, or you're Johnny Kickpads, or you're Mr. Five Star, or you're Flippy Dippy, or you're Brawler, or you're Gaga, it's like there's something about you in some capacity that's given them a reason for you to be here in the first place. And there's only limited positions. And there's lots of people that want in. And the last person out with the group to break through was Omar. Omar and the Saints as well. And recently Deacon. But it turns out being like, oh, you're in. Like, Omar's in. He's in. And the Saints are fucking brilliant. And Deacon's going to fit in nicely. Because also, he's a lovely guy as well. But again, I feel like I've known him forever, and I don't, and I do. It's the weirdest fucking thing with him. The weirdest fucking thing.
What I will say is that my brother's got autism. You've met my brother, actually. It's one of the few pictures he has of a wrestler. is with yourself. So I get. I don't know if I've got it or if I've picked up traits from him growing up. But yeah, like I say, everyone's on the spectrum somewhere somehow. Like if I arrange a chat, like yesterday, like of course we're going to be recording this at 1. He messaged me and said, "Can we do it 2?" That's fine. That was cool because that's an hour out of my day because I've kind of scheduled this like a 3-hour block mentally, thinking right, maybe about 3 hours. There we go. And then we said, oh, it's going to be 2 o'clock because, you know, we're both trying to stay awake for after WrestleMania. I'm like, that's fine. Okay, an hour. I can swing that. That's fine. Yeah. If you messed me, went, can we make it 5? I think my brain would have went into meltdown going, no. No. No, it's not. Yeah. Speaking of Omar, though. Okay.
I totally agree with that there. Like, you know, just someone, there's something that seems trivial to someone else saying, no, let's make it 5 o'clock. Just we'll throw your whole day off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sorry. I agree with you.
So Omar sent ask Scotty about this, and hopefully you can see it. It's a it's a gif of Winnie the Pooh floating.
Yeah, so if in the chat, and like if something terrible happens, or someone alludes to something terrible happening, or someone fucks up in some way and they draw attention to it, it's just like just someone leaving their body in reaction to it. It just makes me laugh every time. I'll just be looking for gifts looking for bodies floating and just see what I get. That'll do.
Well, that's a frequent gif on Scotty Swift's phone.
Oh God, yeah, just like yeah. So if someone or something leaving their body temporarily, it's like, oh, what the fuck's happened today? It's all float. I don't want to be around anymore.
I missed in the bit where we were speaking about the returns on the Regal Rumble. I'll get it in now because I know at least one person will want me to mention it. Ted O'Keefe still has me blocked on Twitter, so fuck him. Right, okay, so moving on. There's one guy who came out and everyone was like, oh, and I was like, fuck him, he's blocked me on Twitter, you can fuck off. Right, so I've got questions from Vicky Vago. Vicky Vago man. Which it was one offhand comment in on one of the mosh pits that he made, and every time I see him, he's like, "Here you go, man." It's that, and Kaylee pointing out that Murphy looks like he just says Murphy, Murphy, Murphy all the time. It's little things that ruin wrestlers a little bit for me. So every time I see him, he's like Murphy, Murphy, Murphy. Anyway, right, get some questions. After becoming a massive football fan after taking part in the World Cup sweeper last year, can we expect Scotty to pit his footballing knowledge against the boys in the WrestleZone Fantasy Football League next season?
Probably not. I didn't. It's like I entered the sweeper because I wanted to win money, and I didn't win money, so it's like, oh, I'm out. I don't care now. I don't care. And also, it's like I only ever enter these fantasy football things because I know someone will laugh at the fact that I've entered it. It's just a pop them. So I don't know what I'm doing. And I said I'll get the constant barrage of questions from Vago and Martin and Dennis and Thunder. And it's like you know I can't answer. So I'll be on Google trying to find something that I can come back with. I did that one time. Like, oh my God! And yeah, I googled it. I don't know what I'm talking about.
What is offside? It's the old Shawn Michaels typing.
Yeah, the AOL. I don't know what offside. I've no idea what offside is. I don't know. I've not a clue.
So comments below. Explain what offside is, so I don't have to. Right. I don't know. I did know when I was like 10, but I'm 32 now. I don't care. I don't care what it is. He's also asked how much. God, he's butchered this question. How much wrestling promotions does Glasgow and the surrounding area really need?
Well, I think we kind of covered that already.
More. That's right. More. And if you sign up to the UK Wrestling Council for £60, you can get your own promotion.
We're here to help entrepreneurs. Now, if there's too much when the promotions lineups all start looking the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and it's like that's a red flag. So it's like this is the same company under four different names. Got it.
Why? There's gonna be an open. Oh no, I was about to. Fuck, I don't care. It's going to be a Mark Monroe open challenge on the show, so you know who's running that one. Okay, so I feel bad for the boy, but he's always in open challenges, and you know who his opponent's going to be. And last question he asks is, can I have an import? Which is always Vegas' question.
If you want. There's not much I can fucking do about it.
He might have Archer Taker soon. You know, that's an import.
Archer Taker.
just get him some Survivor Series 2000 snakeskin trousers.
That was not a good look. That was not a good look.
Archer can pull it off. I'm sure it'll be fine.
Okay.
Bring that down. Hopefully my predictions for Anarchy. Right, okay. So we have the Undisputed WrestleZone champion. He was slid into my DMs with a question.
Uh-oh.
Well, actually, it wasn't even a question. He just put, "Let Scott know I don't rate Bret Hart."
Oh, fuck off. Oh, no. Fuck off. Honestly. Fuck you, Faith.
And follow up with that.
That's genuinely more offensive than the Aberdeen Wankathon comment. I'm not okay with that at all.
Former WrestleZone Undisputed Champion Damien has asked. There's a question mark at the end there. The Exorcist is vastly boring. Overrated movie. Thoughts?
Fuck off. Dick. Why are you lying? Just tell him fucking dirty lies. Dirty lies.
Was the last? I think it was the last one we chatted. You were talking about The Exorcist 2 being amazing movie for awful reasons.
Oh, just like, oh, and a train wreck of epic proportions.
So we've got Ronan King here. We're going to go back to the Regal Rumble stuff. He's going, how badly was Ronan King screwed out of the 2023 Regal Rumble?
Well, I mean, if you hadn't pissed about on the floor for 10 minutes before coming in and paid attention, you might not have got eliminated. You absolute divvy. And I know, it's like, someone as talented as he is just taking his eyes off it. Like, okay, you should reign as well, though, Ronan. You should reign.
He may have maxed out when he came out with his glasses saying number 25 when he actually came out at number 24 because Archer wasn't in the match.
Yeah.
So that's right.
He jinxed it right from the start. Youth of today. Youth is wasted in the young.
These damn kids working with children and whatever else CM Punk said when he was eating muffins. And the other part of that question is how good would the Undisputed title look around his waist if Damien didn't ruin it?
I think it would look good in his waist. I think we said before that the belt's beautiful, so it kind of looks good in anyone. But I think Ronan with the championship would be a good fit. Drip. Is it drip?
Possibly. Drip. I mean, if you say something's got a drip, I would suggest going to the A&E, but that's just me. I'm old.
but whatever, Luke, that's a good fit. A good look for him. A good look.
It would be on fleek.
Right, there you go.
Booyashaka.
Wow.
I went high with fleek and then went very low with Booyashaka, which I think is maybe a reference that's like from the 90s with Ali G. So we've got a great question from Callum. Callum Bruce, of course, which I was, when this question came in, I was like, yes, Callum, this is an excellent question. It was, well, he's put book Aberdeen Anarchy 2020 if we got it. So,
oh God.
Maybe not all the matches, but if you could, if the 2020, of course, before it was, I was going to say before Ronan King, you go, there's the timestamp for you in the world. So a lot of things are going to happen at Regal Rumble, a lot of debuts as well. My favorite, of course, to win it was Zach Dynamite. I think I said that before the show happened. So it could have been Dynamite Damien on that show. Who knows? Pre-pandemic, what would you like to see at that 2020 Aberdeen Anarchy?
I can't remember what things looked like before the pandemic, Billy. I can't remember.
You had a healthy supply of hair dye. I think that was what happened pre-pandemic. Crusher was still here. He's still alive.
But the way, no, Crusher's not dead. They say that. No, the way Crusher was with us. Yeah, he's not fucking dead. So the Academy show was the last show before the pandemic. We had Vago against Alan Sterling. You had a Dynamite against Crusher. Myself and Caleb with a torn my groin and cracked my pelvis. It was my thought, not his. Honestly, I had to put myself back in that. That was like 3 years ago, and I genuinely, my brain fried. I just can't.
We were supposed to have guys like what's it called, Winston, Madison Miles was supposed to make debut. So there was quite a few like new faces coming in.
Yeah, I just honestly, I can't remember. It was an amazing. I've been 20 years ago. I just that whole time period and just everything shut down. I just can't remember. I mean, I could have in general 2020. I'd have seen Dynamite and Damien being a thing. We got it. We just got it 2 years later.
Mm-hmm.
The foundation of the future. They were kicking about then. They were going strong. Connor and Crusher were tag champions.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, when Anarchy 2022, there'd probably be a handful of matches that happened at Anarchy 22 that would have happened in 2020 if the world hadn't ended. Because there's definitely the button of heads with certain people who were definitely going in that kind of general direction. Myself. With the outfit, I had my issues with them before the pandemic, I think. And Umar had been in for Proving Grounds the year before, and I'd likely have seen him involved in a rumble in some way as well. So it wouldn't have been as vastly different, I don't think. But I mean, a lot can happen in 2 years, so I don't know. It's a really good question that I'm just not prepared for at all, because my brain in that period is just fried. Move on 1 second. Hold on, come on then.
That's fine. I need to go for a second as well, so I'll be back in a minute.
Go. Hello.
Hello, and we're back. I don't know what I'll use. I don't know what we'll use in between. Oh, refuel.
It's my Ghostbusters of Aberdeen mug.
Ah, very nice. I don't know what I'm going to do. I think I might use the. I don't know if you've seen the technical difficulties, Brian Tucker thing I've got for. use that in between for that little break there.
Please do.
We've got the car seats have arrived, the next stage one, and the boxes are humongous. Right. Oh. So had to move those, and I'm fucking knackered. Right. Anyway, so back onto the show. So we do have a couple more questions. Well, one more question through Instagram, and then it kind of leads me into a nice little bit to go down memory lane and hopefully not going into any more rants about idiots.
I promise nothing.
I know. I know. So we've got Kirsten Louise Photography. Of course, I've spoke about them and recently for Regal Rumble because she's a new fan. She's only found out about you through Comic-Con and is immersed in WrestleZone lore already. She has asked, what's one of your fondest memories from being a wrestler, or what's your proudest moment?
I think, again, this might cover some of the ground we've already spoken about, so I won't dwell on it too long. And if you want to go back in the archives and get more, you can push the previous podcast on there. Making the debut, having that first match, you know, that's always going to be a big one, because not realizing that, oh, I can actually do this. And then, like I said before about Johnny giving me a kick up the butt and stuff and being, you know, like, you can do this. Headlining the ballroom for the first time is good. The 2015 match with Joe Coffey and making the entrance and had Keelan and Shorty Swift with the flag coming out for the entrance. I think so, man. And I mean, I think they've both grown up and moved on to other things and stuff, because that's what kids do, you know, like the both faces and stuff. But gave them a really nice memory. That was good. What do you think, Billy? I mean, like, you've been following it for 10 years. There's a lot of pride at the moment. I mean, it was just, even with the first ballroom show, and just, oh, it's really busy tonight. It sold out, you know. Like, me and a bunch of pals used to jump about in people's back gardens doing backyard wrestling, and now we're like, how did we get to, like, 1,103 people in the beach ballroom with Billy Gunn and Jim Duggan? How did that happen? You know, it's like, that kind of stuff. Like, yeah. Should be a little, as well, you know, just, you know.
I mean, there's, of course, yeah, because I've been watching, I've seen you for 10 years now. Coming June will be 10 years since I saw my first WrestleZone show. So, to throw stuff out there for you, of course, yeah, the ballrooms, worst matches, teaming with X-Pac and all that kind of thing. One that, of course, didn't really become a fond memory, but just thought of it in general, was when I got to see you wrestle at ICW at the Granite City, Granite City Fight Club. Even though it didn't become a fond memory, just the moment of it, of you coming out on that show was still quite, was so cool, because I think Crusher was on that show as well against Lionheart.
I think it was the first time they came, Damien was in a tag match and Crusher had the match with Lionheart, and the second time
That's the one. Jackie Polo was the champion when you were on the show. That was it. And I got that amazing picture of Ryan Riley looking up an inflatable sheep's arse. There we go. But anyway, yeah, but no, seeing you enter that, I was like, that's pretty cool. Even though the match got cut, I thought that's at least a cool moment for me anyway, because I've got to see you wrestle so often. Little things, like I say, for you, it sounded like for you, it's like your proudest moment was creating memories for like the Mini Swift and Caleb and all that kind of stuff. It was doing that. And for me, you've created a lot of memories, because I wouldn't have been as into WrestleZone without the great guys that are on the show. And why have I suddenly got emotional? This is weird. I'm tired. I'm very tired. But I was saying, you've created so many emotions. So is the guys at WrestleZone as well in general. That's why I keep coming back. That's why it's going to be 10 years in June since I've come to shows, because you keep giving me reasons to come back. I've stopped going to the shows for different varying reasons for other promotions, but I keep coming back to Aberdeen as well. So it's just you've done good at the wrestling stuff. I think that's probably the best way I could put it.
It's like,
That's the thing about WrestleZone. You don't have to be like the flippy doodad. You don't have to do the technical stuff. You create memories, and that's the most important thing, for especially for me anyway. If you see my reviews, if I haven't watched the show back, they're very much emotive based reviews.
Yeah.
Because I don't remember the moves. I remember how I felt during the match and how I felt during the moves. And often it would be, your match would be one of my favorites, because you created an environment that everyone enjoyed being part of. I mean, the last match that we've seen you in would have been that Ellen one against Super Executioner, which is hilarious in all manner of speaking, but it worked because you're both hilarious and it made it work. So it's just, yeah, you make memories, and that's what you've done. And hopefully you'll do it again. But that's just the best thing that a wrestler can do, is create memories.
Same to some of the younger guys who are so like, because again, it's almost like it's a generational thing, and it's like waves. I mean, like, wrestling has been long enough now that it's almost like, you know, it's like there's been waves of people coming through, and we're in the era right now where is the most capable physically we've ever had in terms of like what guys can do. But a very, very, it's not just me, there's a lot of the guys who feel the same way. Is what you're doing from a capable point of view when you're 20, it might not come as easy to you when you're 40, but no matter how old you are, you can make moments. And moments and basic human emotion are never going to go out of fashion. Like, night one of WrestleMania was so, so good. I loved night one. I thought it was incredible because the stories were compelling. And that's never going to go out of fashion. But if you're relying on just getting by and just the physicality of what you're doing, there'll come a time in your life where it won't come as easy to you, and you might be hamstrung by it. Story, characters, moments will work whether you're 20, 30, 40, or 50, or God forbid 60. Because it's all up here, you know. And the physical stuff will go, because fortunately, you know, your body will slow down, and time will tell you you can't do that flippy doodle anymore. Or it's not going to come as easy to you. So be capable. If you're athletically gifted, do it. But you also need to not forget about the fact that stories and moments and characters are, in my opinion, are more important. Because I said before, if people are just reacting to the move and not the person doing the move, then you're throwing away an opportunity to really get people into what you're doing. And I had to do that because I can't do all the flippy doodle stuff. So I had to be the guy who, you know, moments and stories and stuff. And when I was in my 20s, and when I was in my 40s, there wasn't much difference physically in the grand scheme of things because I didn't do anything daft in the first place. So I could still do generally what I did when I was in my 20s. Maybe not quite as quick, but I would get there. So, but yeah, the a long-winded answer to her question, but thank you very much for, she was at the Comic-Con, I was at the Comic-Con simply for the fact that whether the ring was there or not, I would still be at a Comic-Con in Aberdeen because I was going to go to it. And I was cameraman, I was referee, I was ring announcer throughout the course of the day. And I had a really, really good time. And it was very successful for everyone involved. And about halfway through the day, I started really struggling because I wasn't wrestling. And then I wasn't there on the Sunday because I couldn't manage it. But I don't think I'd have been able to be there both days because halfway through Saturday, I was like, I'm having a hard time now. But the ring announcing was so much fun. I didn't have a microphone, so I just shouted. Which is fine, I can do that. That's fine. And refereeing is a thankless job because it's not as easy as you think it is. Especially when you've got Conor Malloy and Zach Dynamite and Chris Archer in like a triple threat match, and they're just moving. And I was like, oh my God, they're moving. This is hard.
I mean, I suppose your muscle memory as well is trying to pull you in positions to be a wrestler as well when you're thinking, no, I'm a referee. I don't need to be anywhere near this. At the same time.
And as well, stupid little things like watching people's toes, the toes of people's feet, because wherever their toes are pointing, that's where they're going to take off, so get out of the way. So just looking at people's footwork to try and anticipate what they're doing before they even know what they're doing, so I'm out the way. And when the ring's full of people, when you get three people or four people, that's when it gets tricky. So Dennis and Mikey are so much better than most people realize. But yeah, thank you, Kirsten, for the question. It took me forever, and Billy had to help me.
Billy almost had a cry. That's the hour sleep for you and a monster.
Oh yeah. No, we're blaming WrestleMania and the lack of sleep for the emotional state that we're
that's
in.
That's it. I'm not crying over Scotty Swift retiring. No, that's not it at all.
I saw you. We all had a wee moment.
We did.
And I,
we...
wasn't,
we didn't really speak about that. You know, your last match. We talked about the circumstances and what Rhys Dawkins did with his big bloody book, but we didn't actually speak about the reaction and just that whole. It just deflated. The whole room deflated when that three count hit.
I wasn't going to say anything on the microphone, but I felt like I had to.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the moment, I was like, but then. But then I also didn't want to make it completely about myself.
Mm-hmm.
Is why I said a little thing about Umar, and I meant it. Like, he is the future. I really don't know what I can really add to it or I can really say. And again, it's like we speak about, and again, another thing we have spoken about, and me and Caleb speak about, the like imposter syndrome, where people perceive you as more than what you perceive yourself as, because you still haven't gotten your head around the fact that like you're like a wrestler,
mm-hmm.
which is still like an amazing thing to be. And again, talking about having like limited positions in a company, and you're one of 20 people. Which is mental. When you think about it, you break it down out of everyone, that's mental. And so, like, you've got your perception of what you are, and me and Caleb speaking at this regularly. And then the reaction that I got, I had to remind myself that it's like, yeah, but you got to remember, Scott, like, the way you see yourself is not the way people perceive you. And mm-hmm. A lot of the people at the show were at the first Aberdeen show in June of 2008. So it's been like almost 15 years that they've like followed the ups and downs of what we've all been doing. So it was like a wee reminder of like, oh shit. Like, it is important. You know what I mean?
It's mm-hmm.
like just, And like unless you've got a really high opinion of yourself, or you're just really, really overly confident, and that doesn't have to be a bad thing. I mean, it can be a bad thing. It doesn't have to be a bad thing. It's like, unless you're that kind of person, I just, like, you're guilty of not realizing, like, ah, shit, it's fucking, you know, there's people, the action figures made of me, and, mm-hmm. you know, the homemade, and you show up with homemade t-shirts and stuff, and it's like, ah, shit. It's like, okay, it is the imposter syndrome. It's the not being able to quite grasp the fact that to someone else you are something important or special. And
in the same kind of vein, you're speaking about Caleb then, and of course I've thrown Kel into the bus in a lot of these podcasts, but she was proper. She got up and she was properly emotional about Caleb winning, but it was because she said afterwards, she's going, I saw his first appearance in the Rumble, and that was one of his first matches. So I saw him in 2019 when he started, and now I'm seeing, and he killed Malice for the first time. And now I'm seeing him in the same match again, 4 years later, and winning it. And I've seen that journey, and that's what makes it even more special and emotional. It does help that Caleb is the loveliest human in the world, and he kept checking tabs on both of us when, shit was happening in real life, kind of thing. And it's just that kind of person. But the fact that she saw that journey made it all the more special. I mean, for myself, of course, I've seen you guys for the last 10 years. And to put it another way, another one that I enjoy watching is Emerson Jane. And I saw her second match in 2012 against Nikki Storm. So to see what she's doing now, I'm just like, yeah, I've seen that journey. So that's what makes it, if she gets signed somewhere, that's going to be a very emotional moment for me, because I've seen her wrestle for 10 years now, from our very much very beginning. So when I see guys like seeing Ronan get booked for Wrestle Carnival, for example, I'm like, yeah, I'm seeing this journey, because these guys are, I mean, for lack of a better term, 10 years, as old as my family when it comes to wrestling. So now I'm seeing the kids go out and make themselves, and you guys must be even more proud, because you've helped lent a hand, actually giving them the tools to create those opportunities and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know where we started with that. It was proudest moments, and then we've kind of just kind of went into a wee, wee emotional base of going, wrestling's pretty bloody good.
Yeah, it can. Yeah, if you. Wrestling can be, again, wrestling done right. I say done right, you know, it's some cocky, this is done right, but like done with a level of attention and care, and done with more than just here's two guys in tights having a match. And it's almost, you know, like that kind of Pavlovian response to, well, he came out first, so I'll boo him, and the good guy must be second. But I want more than that, though. I want more than that. I don't want it to just be wrestler A versus wrestler B. I want it to be people have their favourites. You know, it's like, and you can grab 20 people, and they'll all give you, I mean, obviously, there's going to be some people that will like Caleb, will like Aspen. Is there really like, they're the two top guys right now, in my opinion. But, you know, you're going to get a sweeping, like there's a lot of people that really like Connor. Like some of the kids gravitate towards Connor because he's younger and more athletic, and he's just a nice fucking guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's some of your older crowd who are a little bit smarter really like the Foundation Boys, which is cool, you know. Although they're dickheads, damn them, you know. And there's people that have been following it for a long time that really like Damien, because he's just like a constant. He's just like, you know, again, it's going to be good, a constant. So it's like people, you could pull 20 people and get a wide variety of different answers, which is, and even if it is just like people saying, oh, I like the guy who came out with the funny sunglasses. You know, at least it's something, you know, because they might not know them by name if it's their first time, but they're going to leave and there'll be something about their character or their look where they can say, you know, I like the guy that came out with the horn and did stall. Mm-hmm. They might not know his name, but look, I like him. Or, you know, so, or the guy with the pigtails, you know, because that happened at the Comic-Con. So I like him with the pigtails. But Aspen, yeah, because you like pigtails. He's like, his demographic at the Comic-Con was like young girls because they liked his fingernails and his pigtails. Mm-hmm. He's my favourite. But they're going to leave now, and they're going to tell their friends, I thought the guy with the pigtails was great. He spoke to me, and I got a picture with him. So, oh, no, like, no, when are they wrestling next? So let's go and see them. And that's what happens. It isn't just a guy in boots and a pair of tights doing some wrestling, and then going away again. I don't want that. I want, who are you? Why do I care?
And
if you sit up in that way, that's when you can start telling stories. And then that's when you get people like yourself that be coming for 10 years, and you can tell stories to people that be coming for 10 years because there's history to call upon. And I hate cold wrestling shows.
Yeah.
And there's a place for them, and I'm not being a dick. It's just my personal preference. And it's like, and there's some companies who just do nothing but cold wrestling shows. What are you creatively getting? What's your fulfillment from a creative standpoint? Because I want to be telling stories and being creative. I want to give people moments, and just doing a show and then go away and then doing the other show, and they're all separate and they're all just like isolated shows, and it's fine, but I wouldn't get any fulfillment out of that. It's fine, but I don't want fine. I want people to be invested in what's happening, and I don't think enough places do it. I don't think enough places do it well or well enough. And I know I'm biased, but again, my eyes and ears are my barometer. So,
yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, for me, like you say, when it comes to, I've been going to wrestling long enough now, so my barometer for not is it good or not, that's not the best way to put it, would be if Kelly enjoyed it. That's now my barometer, because she only comes to wrestling. She doesn't watch wrestling on TV. It doesn't interest her. She likes the live experience. So now seeing her excited is what makes me more excited about the show, is because I'm like, I could sit there and be a critical prick the whole time if I wanted to be. I could go, oh, that move didn't work. Oh, that would... But to see people emotionally be invested in each show, that's the best bit about wrestling for me. The wrestling's almost secondary. It's the stories you tell. So, yeah, I think we're all in agreement.
Definitely.
So before we kind of, so we're hoping for 3 hours, but I don't think either of us is going to probably make it 3 hours. Aberdeen Anarchy is soon. When this comes out, it'll be like 2 weeks away. You've talked about your own fond memories of Aberdeen Anarchy, of course, being in the main event and all that kind of jazz. What's been your kind of favorite Aberdeen Anarchy moments out with yourself?
The first Anarchy 2013, and when Martin did his introduction. Martin did his introduction, and obviously I'm not out front at this point, but I'm close enough to the curtain, and it isn't like the crowd reaction, it wasn't like a yay, it was a because it was so much people. To us, it may as well have been WrestleMania, 90,000 people. And Martin's doing all he can to hold it together. Could you tell he's a way to fucking start bubbling? And it's like, oh shit. And it's like, and then from that point forward for that show, just everyone's emotions were so, were so heightened, because it was this sense of, well, we've done it, you know. And the crowd, just hearing the crowd, and the difference between like 250 people being noisy versus 1,300 is like, oh my god, it's a big difference. Anarchy moment, I was like, Scotty Tuhati against Rado was a riot. For a long time, it was like speaking to Mikey, who refereed the match, speaking to Mikey about it after the fact, and it's how much fun he had being in there. I was living vicariously through him telling me after the fact how much fun he had. And just the fact that Grado was absolutely fucking shit. And Scotty was just like, very calmly trying to keep him even keeled. Because Scotty can do this in his sleep now, you know, it's funny. That Dynamite having the match with Pat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 2019.
Because, Pat can fucking go. He can really go. And that Dynamite was there with him. That's a feather in his cap. So that's like leveling up there. There's so much Anarchy moments. There's so much. Archer getting put to the table by T-Von.
Yeah.
Just to sign the table. Man, it was a gun going off. I got a big kick out of Dano against the Tanker, to be honest with you. Just two big cunts fighting.
And then he also got Looking Sharp against Hornswoggle on the same show.
It's mental. It was with Looking Sharp speared. Was it Looking Sharp speared Hornswoggle? He just went. Oh god, the visual. Yeah, Anarchy. It's so much great stuff. You know, like Crusher's final match.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and his little farewell afterwards, with the main event of that one, the triple threat with Aspen, Damien, and Zach. I could literally be just like rattling off.
But every match.
Here's things that were really good. You know, a lot of stuff. Like Duggan, no, the biggest reaction we've ever had on our show is still when Duggan came out. Mm-hmm. There hasn't been a reaction bigger than Jim Duggan's entrance. There's nothing. We've had good reactions. We've had great reactions. We've had like genuine, you know, like the difference between, like, to use a recent example, I was saying to Caleb the reaction of the good guy winning and people being happy versus the reaction of the man you wanted to win this year's Rumble are different. Because when the guy that you want to win the Rumble wins, it's like this, it's almost a fucking relief. It's like this weight has been lifted off of everyone's shoulders, because all the drama, and when they finally see their guy or the guy that they wanted to win, it's like a fucking, more than the guy winning. It's like this visceral thing. It's like it was three o'clock in the morning after the legal rumble, and Caleb's like about, I don't know, like five beers deep or something, and he's like, I can't sleep. And I said to him, winning a rumble is a rush, isn't it? It's like, it's amazing. It's like, it's different. It's more than. It's definitely more than. It's more than just a good guy winning. It's like, it's when your guy wins. And mm-hmm. It's like, yeah. And you can, and again, that's special. And you don't get those reactions every time. You know, like, winning a championship or winning a rumble or those kind of things are more than. And, Just funny. He couldn't sleep, and I was, I don't know why I wasn't in my bed, but I was, again, it's a control thing. I was off the next day, so I had to stay up late. I should be in my bed. I should be in my bed, but I wasn't because control. I had control this time. I'm not going to bed. And I see Caleb still up in his place. I can't sleep. I'm still buzzing. It's good, isn't it? It's amazing, because it's more than.
I think that's a great way to kind of close up the podcast. This has been, it's been a little bit different. Last few times I've just kind of sent you on tangents, but this one's been a little bit more. This has been like the most grown up episode of the podcast where we've had emotional moments. I did a two minute terrible advert for manscaped.com. If you go to manscaped.com and SWN20, 20% off, free shipping, and you can also have your balls nice and smooth. Anyway, right, okay. So, is there anything you want to plug before we kind of go for a nap, not together. Go for a nap before WrestleMania.
That'd be weird. We'll go for a nap together. Well, Aberdeen Anarchy tickets are on sale. We've got two shows at the Wrestling Training Academy, one in the afternoon and one at night. Ringsideworld.co.uk, you'll get all the. Again, apparently, WrestleZone is ranking really high in their search thing now, so that's nice to see. So. April 22nd, the Academy shows. May 13th is Aberdeen Anarchy. I will live vicariously through everyone on those three events. I'm sure they'll be great. I'm sure Omar and Caleb and Vago will give me all the grisly details afterwards. You know, if anything happens to the ring, Thunder will moan at me about it, although it's not my responsibility. Maybe the ghost of Mr. Malice will appear in some capacity. I don't know.
You only hope.
I don't know how he fell vertical after seeing that. He's got some kind of death wish I don't understand. But hey, it's once a year, so he's making the most of it. God knows what goes through his old brain, but
mush at this point after seeing his head hit the apron. But yeah, Aberdeen Anarchy, I can't wait for it. Of course, when this goes out, the Training Academy shows will have happened. But if you're on Patreon, you would have heard that little plug for it. So go to it. But
still staying on that note. I know Anarchy is the big one. Anarchy is like Anarchy's over half sold out already. So here you go. People want to see it. Don't sleep on the Academy shows because the vibe's different. If you've never been to the Academy, you get a chance to see the facilities. They're great. Different vibe, intimate, smaller. It's almost like a fight club thing. Mm-hmm. You had to go down that wee lane to get to it. It's not a speedy, it's not like a dark lane. You had to go down a lane to find it. Like, everything signposted. and it's almost like this underground secret little like thing for like 40 people, and it's like they're cool, they're different. I would check it out, but Anarchy is always a good time, and Aston Faith against Killer Valhalla is a hell of a match, and I'll look forward to seeing it after the fact. And thank you, Billy Strachan. Always a pleasure, and never a show.
Perfect. Thank you very much.